Okay, well, I think...
For the representative to sign along.
Thank you.
I think I'll call this meeting to order, this, at 9:06, 7. This is the subcommittee for dispatch for Carroll County. Represented here for the delegation is Representative Tysik and Representative Ted.
Right.
Right.
Representative Ted.
And our other members, if they could introduce themselves, I would appreciate it to everybody. I could start over there. Yes.
Representative Santuccio, Chair of Office.
Thank you.
Keith Brown.
Keith. You want to join us? You're welcome to.
Dominic, Chair.
Dave Babson, Commissioner.
Carter.
Carter, Terenzini, Town Administrator in Moultonboro.
Good morning, Dave Owen, Town Manager in Wolfeboro.
Okay, so I think we have Representative Wright. I didn't hear back from her, so I don't know if she's coming or not. And I believe the Town Administrator from Conway, I don't...
I didn't hear back.
I didn't hear back from him either. So I guess we'll start with what we have. I had requested some information from the sheriff, and I was hoping I'd get it a little earlier so I could really look at it, but we'll have to breeze over it quickly, or maybe if we have any questions, or the sheriff could give us some information before we get into the meat of it. The information that I had requested was call... let me just refresh everybody what I was kind of looking for. I sent an email to the sheriff asking for which jurisdictions, county, state, municipal, and others do the sheriff dispatch service to. Is the dispatch their primary or their backup? How many calls have been dispatched on behalf of each jurisdiction over the last several years? Please note that a call to a sheriff's department making service in Moultonboro is being made on behalf of the jurisdiction of the Carroll County Sheriff's Office, not the town of Moultonboro. A call to the sheriff's deputy who made a traffic stop in Moultonboro is being made on behalf of the jurisdiction of the Carroll County Sheriff's Office, not the town of Moultonboro. A call to the sheriff's deputy conducting primary patrol in Albany is made on behalf of the jurisdiction of Albany and not the Carroll County Sheriff's Office. And my third question was, would you please break down the health insurance, FICA, Medicare, workman's comp, retirement, etc., for the dispatch operation? So I have to assume, Sheriff, that those are the answers are in these pieces of paper that you just gave us?
Somewhat, for the most part.
Okay.
I believe I put word to you that I disagree with your jurisdiction definition.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
The only jurisdiction that happens to break up the way you had asked is the sheriff's office, because the sheriff's office does not have a town. We have a whole town.
Right.
So any town we do something in, it's the jurisdiction of that town. But we can also pull it out as a sheriff's office for our own statistics for year-end reports. But we don't do that for every town.
Okay. Commissioner.
Just to make it clear, Madam Chairman, Sheriff, am I correct? Ossipee, with its very large number, that's because anything that happens in here is credited to Ossipee?
Yes.
So there's no way of an actual figure of how many of these are Ossipee numbers and how many are they're sheriff's all, department because they're in an Ossipee?
Right. They're all Ossipee numbers. If there was no sheriff's department, it'd be all handled by Ossipee PD.
Mm-hmm. And vice versa. Here, there is no Ossipee PD.
And vice versa. If there was no Ossipee PD, it'd all be handled by the sheriff's department or
right.
the state police, obviously.
But my question is, Don, you can't split out
no.
what is actually a call for service from Ossipee and one which is a call here because you're in Ossipee.
We potentially could.
It would be
take a lot of
it would
searching.
Be a, it would be a call-by-call poll.
Oh, no, that's okay. Well, let's just understand that figure is then.
Yeah, that's just the way the software IMC runs it. It's, if you ask, it does by towns, jurisdiction towns. It doesn't do by departments.
Okay.
Okay.
And every other town you see is skewed by that same reason.
Mm-hmm.
Anything we do in any town, it's not a sheriff's office call. It's the town call. Because we're... subletting or basically helping your agency by stopping a car that maybe they didn't get to or happened to be going by while we were there, so.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
That helps explain the numbers a little bit. I know I shared these response numbers with our police commission and the police chief at a meeting a month or so ago, and they were very surprised to see, you know, such a large number of calls for service from Wolfeboro, because they said, you know, so far as they know, there's very minimal assistance that they you know, direct assistance that they get dispatch service for Wolfeboro. But if it includes all the stops and everything, we know that you're very active in Wolfeboro. We see the you're right around the corner from Wolfeboro, and we like the county sheriff's presence and their activity in Wolfeboro. So that helps to explain for it, because the department says that, you know, there's very little assistance directly. There was an incident, I think, the weekend before last, a fire call that went from Wolfeboro that went to the county dispatch, but there were simultaneous calls that went to Wolfeboro from other people that saw the fire, and it turned out to be a coding error with the state E911 system that they had it in as a Ossipee address rather than than a Wolfeboro address. So, you know, things like that happen.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Well, one other thing before you get really deep into this, can you and the folks in the sheriff's department explain why Tuftonboro, of all places, has the second highest number of calls? Such a small community?
Without breaking it out specifically, right. We really can't say if it's, you know, burglaries, or if we have car stops, or if there is civil service or anything. We just know that
they're a very active department.
They are. I mean, that department.
They were.
I mean, since being back, I mean, I haven't noticed anything different that is happening outside around Tuftonboro PD itself,
mm-hmm.
As far as the normal occurrences, as far as a civil overload of papers or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't noticed any big changes to any one town as far as the outside sheriff's office business in each town. So it's most likely it's self-induced by Tuftonboro PD and fire.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Is it fair to assume that the bigger the department, the more calls you're going to get, the more people that are on duty? And so Tuftonboro has four officers, whereas, you know, Sandwich doesn't have that many. So
right, they're one of the bigger departments that are not one of the three, other than Wakefield.
They are very active motor vehicle wise too. So
just as a point, where we keep going back to law enforcement, this is activity in the town of Tuftonboro, police, fire, EMS, civil service.
So this is the calls could
accidents.
Be it could be a multitude of things, not just a
right.
sheriff going
right.
Or stopping a car. My one of my questions is the top number 48,667 for Carroll County Sheriff. Is that just your calls? I mean, how are we distinguishing those numbers? You say that you don't know how to take out Ossipee, but you have your own call number. Is that just dispatching your people?
I can comment to that.
Sure.
The jurisdiction that falls into the sheriff's office is where the bulk of the out-of-county transports originate. So if a deputy leaves here to go to the New Hampshire State Prison to do a transport, we utilize the sheriff's office jurisdiction, which is 00, whereas the other towns are Albany is 01. Uh-huh. We utilize the 00 for the sites. So we would originate the transport at the New Hampshire State Prison, and we have that site underneath our, the 00 jurisdiction code.
Okay.
So anything that, they go to Manchester, they go to YSDU, they go to the New Hampshire State Prison, New Hampshire State Hospital, any of those would originate out of that.
Okay, and if one of your deputies stops a car in Moultonboro?
That would be coded as Moultonboro.
It would be coded as Moultonboro. It wouldn't be your 00 code. So your 00 code is really specific for certain things, not just regular dispatching back and forth to your deputy.
Administrative calls into the office. We are the answering point for the office, so if a call comes in for the civil office,
mm-hmm.
we answer that and transfer it to them.
Okay.
So that would all fall under that.
So phone calls are call of service. You use your phone calls as call of service. Okay.
So over the period of 09, 10, and 11, Conway had north of 150,000 total calls through its system. And Moultonboro had north of 100,000 calls through its system. And Wolfeboro had north of 120,000 calls through its system. You dealt with roughly, in trying to extract some numbers through this, through a reasonable back-of-the-envelope approach, you had roughly less than 2% of their calls. Is it reasonable to assume that in the other jurisdictions, for instance, Bartlett, 2% of those calls were Sheriff's Department calls, or 5%, double it, 2.5 times?
You can make an assumption. I wouldn't be safe making that assumption that it's 2%, especially in certain towns we're more active in because they're more part-time or their guys are on calls more, yeah. So we got to cover another call. I don't think that's safe to assume it is.
No,
bulk of these are,
well,
you know, but for Wolfeboro, obviously the bulk of those are for Wolfeboro, you know.
Sure, stops or whatever.
Yeah.
I'm trying to find some reasonable way in a shortcut to extract out of these 183,000 calls how many were actually for the Sheriff's Department itself, as opposed to Bartlett's PD or the Ossipee Fire District or the others.
We're back to a call by call pick of.
There's no shortcut. So, that's very long.
So you operate the center 24/7 for how many years now?
Since the 1950s.
Well, no, your personal familiarity, your expertise with it.
2 years.
Okay. And you have no gut check as to how many of these are true sheriff's calls in Bartlett as opposed to the Bartlett PD?
I don't think I would want to say 10%, 2%, or 15% because I could be drastically wrong. I mean, it's different for every town. Like I said, we're more active in Freedom than we are in, say, Bartlett. And you could probably say the same with state police as well. So
without a horribly labor-intensive process, how does one try to get some handle on, of those 183,000 calls, are true Sheriff's Department calls, whether you're stopping a car in Moultonboro or you're doing a civil service in Moultonboro, whatever you're doing there, because we know that you're active in all the communities. So, for instance, in Tuftonboro, how do we know some of those are yours, but we also know a lot of those are the Tuftonboro Fire Department and a lot of police department and the like. How do we get down to some, not to a Nat's arse, but some reasonable agreed number so we can then further the discussion on the matter as to what that split is, without you folks having to spend hours upon hours, it's frankly not productive.
The easy answer for me is, from the dispatch standpoint, of the 183,000 plus calls, we were involved in every one of them as a dispatch, and we worked for the sheriff. And we answer the phones for local PDs, and we give them the calls, and we take their emergency calls.
With due respect, you're either missing the point or you're not willing to address the point.
I don't think he's missing the point you're trying to make.
Then perhaps he's unwilling to address the point.
But it
must be that.
I don't think that's fair either. Again, the dispatch is there for the county purpose, for anyone's in the county use. Somehow, way, shape, or form, we take a call into the sheriff's office. This could be generated by any one of the employees of that town, or by a phone call, or by a sheriff's department personnel. It comes into dispatch. The jurisdiction for that call is that town.
You're either unwilling.
Whether it's 1%, 10%, 5%, without doing a time-consuming.
So that's the only way to get to it.
You're talking about if a Wolfeboro car went, or a Moultonboro car went, or a sheriff's office car went, that's time-consuming. The dispatch is involved in all these. But if you're saying, which one did Wolfeboro go to, which one did the sheriff's office go to?
I have my answer. You're saying the only way to get to it is a time commit.
Yes.
Madam Chair, I think we're getting lost in the weeds here with the statistics and such. The basic question that brought everybody together here was that you have three towns that are providing their own dispatch services. In Wolfeboro, we have round-the-clock, 24-hour-day dispatch service, and the last annual report I had showed that we had 44,000 calls during that period. So the town of Wolfeboro, we're spending close to $400,000 a year. I think it's like $395,000 in the current year budget for our dispatch center. In Wolfeboro. And we're also supporting the county dispatch service. I think we figured the three towns that have their own dispatch service are also paying close to 50% of the cost of the county system. So the issue we have is the apportionment of the cost. And if you if the state reps and the county commissioners that are here put on your budget hats, you know, if you were going through your budget, be it the state budget or the county budget, and you found something where you're paying for that service twice, you would think that there's, you know, something the matter there, that would be something you need to address and to fix that problem. Mm-hmm. And that's basically what brought us here. It's an apportionment of the cost issue. No one, to my knowledge, I'm certainly not advocating that Wolfeboro not pay something towards the county system. I think every town should pay some base amount to support the service. It's a valuable service. But whether, you know, we Wolfeboro should be paying 15% of the budget for county dispatch services when we're receiving a very small return in terms of services, that's the question. So I don't particularly want to get lost in the statistics. And we know from the information that was provided earlier, there's other counties right here in New Hampshire that have different cost apportionment formulas that do it differently. So we don't have to reinvent the wheel. There are models out there for how you do this.
And I think it's important that everyone, and I know everyone really knows this, that if Conway, Wolfeboro, and Moultonboro pulled out their dispatch and gave it all to you, to the Sheriff's Department, that you most definitely would have to hire people to cover those kind of calls. And I agree with the gentleman from Wolfeboro that we aren't looking to say, the sheriff's department shouldn't have a dispatch. That isn't what we're saying. We agree that for the common good of the whole county, that you have a dispatch to dispatch your people, your deputies, and to take calls from the constituents for the Carroll County Sheriff's Department. I believe what you're saying is, in a nutshell, is that we, as the three towns paying 50% of that budget, would like to see some type of fee that people that towns should pay above and beyond their county bill to have your service for their town. I believe Albany pays you a certain amount to patrol their town. Is that correct? Okay. But they don't pay you anything extra to dispatch because you're patrolling their town. So they pay a fee for your service. And I believe, you know, it kind of works a little bit like that. You're taking on sandwich, I believe. As you're going to take on their dispatch if you haven't already.
We have their police department, and we're moving forward to possibly take on their fire department, because the town selectmen in Sandwich see a very good cost saving as far as what they're paying Lakes Region. They'll save somewhere around $15,000 just by bringing the fire over. And the fire department would only, if they joined the Ossipee Valley, would only have to pay somewhere around $4,500 instead of the $19,000 they're paying Lakes Region right now. So it's a considerable savings there. Mm-hmm. So we're in the process on that and seeing if they're going to come over.
Which the other towns would pick up in your system, really, the extra, because they're going to turn over to you.
Right.
We as a county would pick up those fees on your county bill.
No, because it wouldn't be anything additional. No, the $4,500 to Ossipee Valley is the fire department itself has to pay the mutual aid assistance.
By taking over Sandwich, it's not like taking over a Moultonboro or a Conway, you know, police department or something. The sheriff made a decision. We don't have to hire another person to handle their dispatch for their police or fire. We have the personnel we have in place is sufficient enough. So the only thing they're looking at doing is a $4,500 fee to be a part of the OVMA mutual aid. Other than that, then that's it. That's what they're looking at. There is not going to be any more costs other than we're handling calls for them, but we have the same amount of people working. We're not hiring anyone else to supplement that.
Okay.
The issue of the calls is not to get lost in the weeds so much as it is to try to put some framework on it. Of the 183,000 calls in that time period, and I'm just going to use some numbers for example only. Let's assume for a moment that 50% of them were solely for the sheriff's department. Let's assume for a moment you weren't dispatching for anybody. So that's 90,000 calls, which is 30,000 calls a year. So the question really becomes, the first step of the question becomes, how much would the county dispatch budget be if it were only dispatching 30,000 calls a year? Not 60,000 calls a year. That's step one. I'm just going through a, not asking for questions, I'm not asking for answers right this minute, just going through a mental process. So let's assume for a moment that it only takes $350,000 a year to dispatch 20,000 calls a year. That's probably not out of the realm of one side or the other of some reality. And the total dispatch budget for the county is?
I was just looking that up.
750, 800?
I have to find it.
Roughly. So we'll say it's $900,000. Okay. So we'll make the comparison even more favorable. Let's say that it takes $500,000 a year to dispatch 30,000 calls. That means that the county of Carroll County, is spending $400,000 a year extra to dispatch for this uptick. That number, That $400,000, assumed for the moment, is the number that is in dispute for Moultonboro, for Wolfeboro, because we're paying half of that. So we need some baseline numbers in order to establish what a baseline budget would be, and then to develop what a pay-for-service approach would look like, we need the numbers because you would need to distribute mm-hmm. out that. So you really do need three pieces to have a good, solid discussion of this issue to me. You need to have some sense of how many of these calls are for these agencies. You need to have a sense of what the uptick is, what the knock-on costs are, and then you need to distribute those in what a pay-for system would look like. Then you can have, to me, a solid, meaningful discussion, because like Wolfeboro, we have no objection to paying for the baseline services for the service department. We know that's for the general good of all of us. We even understand that when you take the knock-on costs and distribute those, we're still going to be paying some of that. But it's a double taxation issue to us, and we don't think we have the base numbers yet to be able to understand that, because we don't even know how much of the budget is going to these knock-on services.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just looking at the whole system and the stability of the system, mm-hmm. and I need a refresher on the history. So the dispatch started in the 60s, is that correct? The Carroll County dispatch?
At least.
Okay, or before. And at the time that it started, did all of the towns participate, or only a few, or do we not know?
I'd have to go to the historian for that.
I think Conway's always had their own dispatch.
Conway is always.
So I'm not sure about Wolfeboro, Moultonboro. They probably came on early on, but everyone else has pretty much always gone through us.
So every town has paid in the same way throughout the history.
Yes.
And towns have always had the option of participating at the same level as the other towns or doing their own system.
Yes.
And my kind of follow-up to the future is, what would changing the way we're doing things now do to our stability and our ability to respond to a really serious emergency in the future? What would the impact be?
If we go to a fee-based system?
Right.
Well, I mean, I think the service would be the same. What I envision seeing changing is other departments now saying, okay, we're charging fees for this and that. Why doesn't Ossipee Fire charge every time they go to the nursing home or to assist another agency in another town? I see it as opening up a can of worms.
Mm-hmm.
As far as, you know, how many people are incarcerated from Moultonboro in the jail? You know, should that not be fee-based then? You know, how many people are staying in the nursing home? So I just see it as blossoming into a fiasco, basically.
And I said it before, is if you're looking at a fee base for dispatch, it's not as simple as that. It's like you said, it's going to open up a bunch of things, and you have to consider those other things before making that decision, whether there's going to be a fee base for, you know, it's as simple as if I don't have any kids in school, why do I have to pay the school bill, you know, school tax? You know, if I don't use the library, why do I have to pay for the library part of the budget? So, and then that's just something that's going to open up. But the services to the county as far as handling emergencies, I don't think you'll see a change. It's just going to be like the town like Ossipee or Albany is going to be saddled with more of the bill. That's all.
Can I follow up?
Sure.
So let's say that We made a different arrangement for the three towns that are requesting it, and then some other towns said, aha, let's do that too. And then we got down to where just a few towns were using the full services. Would there be a point at which you would have to reduce the capacity to handle emergencies in the county?
I don't see that happening. What you're going to do is put a burden on towns that don't have the ability, the Albany's, for one. They don't have a police department, Chatham. Those towns are going to get hit the worst because now they're going to have to pick up the slack because obviously that's where the sheriff's department is answering calls. We're serving the most papers in the towns of Moultonboro and Conway because that's where all the business is. So, again,
but if Moultonboro, Conway, and Wolfeboro decide to come into your dispatch and you have to hire additional personnel, is it not the same? Those towns would certainly, the budget would go way up for sheriff and dispatch. You would have to hire more dispatch people to handle that call volume, which would come back to the county bill. So I think it's apples and oranges kind of thing.
I guess.
And in comparing school districts, the common good for all towns, they send their kids to school whether they have kids, but that's the common good for everyone. If I wanted to send my child, if I made the choice to send my child to Wolfeboro, I would have to pay to do that.
But that's your choice you're making, like a choice that each town is making to have their own dispatch.
To have our own dispatch, fine and dandy, but we didn't choose for you to dispatch personally for some of these towns. I mean, that wasn't our choice for you to do that. I mean, we pay the sheriff's department to dispatch for the sheriff's department, and I think what's happening with the economy being the way it is, I think people are starting to look at why, and especially I will say the taxpayers of Moultonboro are always picking up large tabs because of our assessed value. And I think the people of Moultonboro get sick and tired of it, to be honest with you. And it's not that they're using all the services that they get taxed with. It's just because we live on the lake and we have the most lake frontage. So we get taxed for a lot of things that we don't necessarily use. And I think the people of Moultonboro, which I represent, and I do represent the other towns also, Tuftonboro and Sandwich, but I think that the people of Moultonboro just get tired of looking at, we get taxed for, and we pay other people's taxes because our assessed value is so high. And that might not be a popular thing to say, but it's the truth. And, I just think that with the economy being the way it is, we're just looking for a way to be treated fairly, I think. Commissioner.
I think Representative Crawford, what you were trying to say in your analogy is that there's a law that says you have to go to school.
Right.
There's no law that says you have to have your dispatch center with the sheriff's department.
Thank you very much.
And I wanted to say to Representative Tyser, in case you didn't know, the way it's budgeted here, Representative, is based on your assessed value. And so it really doesn't make any difference the size of the population of these towns. It's based strictly on their evaluation, and is that fair? I don't think so.
And Moultonboro pays almost 25% of that.
Yes. Is that by state legislature, by county? Or, I mean, that's the state tax
that's
rate.
The Department
that's
of
tax
Revenue.
Yeah. Yeah, they said that. We don't. Yeah. The delegation does it. And they just have to follow. We just have to follow their rule, whether we like it or not.
Right.
That's
right.
I just.
Yeah. Okay.
Representative, we would not expect the emergency response capacity of the county to be diminished in any way. We understand there's a certain baseline dispatch capacity that they have to maintain for the sheriff's office. For 30,000 calls a year, it's probably 6 full-time dispatchers, the benefits, the equipment. We understand and expect we need to pay our fair share of that. The issue of, is this going to open up a fee-for-service and the nightmare of the nursing home, the jail? That has not been a subject of discussion or a problem in any of the counties that currently maintain some form of fee-for-service basis, nor has that even been brought up in the most recent county, and I believe that that's Rockingham County, who's looking at this exact same issue. The nursing home is for the common good. The jail is for the common good. The courts are for the common good. Our baseline share of the dispatch service is for the common good. What we're trying to get at here are those knock-on costs, that extra that is maintained only because of the added demand of these additional jurisdictions and calls.
I mean, we have an ambulance service in Moultonboro, and I was on that negotiating team when we first started it. We have four towns that it's like a co-op: Meredith, Center Harbor, Sandwich, and Moultonboro. Now, the contract could have changed since I've been gone, but when we negotiated that contract, we wanted to do it fairly for all towns. So we looked at a base fee that we would all pay to the ambulance service, and then we looked at call for service for each town, and we divided it up so that it was fair to all towns. Meredith had more calls than Moultonboro. Moultonboro had more calls than Sandwich and Center Harbor. So Meredith and Moultonboro paid the biggest share of that bill every year. And it was looked at every fall to go over the numbers. And of course, there was always a cost of living fee that they attached to it every year for gas and whatnot. And then the figures would change if the call for service was higher in Meredith or Moultonboro. So when we negotiated that, we thought that was fair to all four towns. Plus, Moultonboro houses the ambulance for nothing, and the ambulance is closer to Sandwich, so we have calls in Sandwich. The ambulance is in Moultonboro and can be dispatched right away. And that, we as a town decided to do as a good gesture for a good neighbor. So, I mean, I think if, you know, I know it's on a smaller scale, but the towns keep track of those numbers, the ambulance service keeps track of those numbers, and in the fall when they come back to the table, everyone knows how many calls went to each town and really what the cost would be to each one of those towns. It's a fee-based kind of service. Mm-hmm. So I just, you know, I think that's maybe what I'm thinking of when I think of dispatch services. Who uses it the most? Let's pay for the sheriff's department because that's what we need to do as county. And I think that, you know, we'd like to, see other towns that use the service more pay a little bit up front. Yes.
It's relative to this sort of the straw man that the sheriff's office tried to erect here about, if you go to fee for service for the dispatch service, you're going to have to look at, you know, the county jail and the library and the school district and all this. We have examples of four of the 11 counties here in New Hampshire, Grafton, Hillsborough, Merrimack, and Stratford, that have fee-for-service models for charging for their dispatch services. I suspect that if you do some investigation, you'll find that it hasn't carried over to these other areas. Mm-hmm. It's simply a way of allocating cost for this specific service, and it works in other areas. I don't know why it couldn't work here. Perhaps it would have to be phased in over some number of years or something. Mm-hmm. But there seems to me that there would be ways of making this work.
I'm sorry, can you read that list of counties again, please?
Yeah, this is information that was handed out here at, I guess, in 2012 when we started these discussions. Perhaps someone could make copies of this. But it's Grafton, Hillsborough, Merrimack, and Stratford. And they have slightly different formulas that they use, apparently, but there are ways of allocating the cost.
Rockingham is now in these discussions as well.
Along the lines of what we're suggesting.
Rockingham is in these discussions as well.
Oh, yeah.
Driven primarily by dairy, same basic issue.
Rockingham's is only for their upgrade. They're trying to do almost $1 million worth of upgrades to their dispatch center.
Oh.
I think that's where they're trying to. Dairy is complaining that, why do
yes.
I want to pay for your upgrades?
That is what dairy has opened with.
Okay. But that's only for an upgrade purpose, not for a
capital
dispatch afterwards.
Yes.
It
okay.
was only for the opening right. discussion. It is.
I guess it's a delegation decision. Obviously, you know, the sheriff's not in favor of it, but it's a delegation decision. So what do you need more from us to make the decision?
I guess if I can turn the tables a bit. Moultonboro pays about $85,000 to Lakes Region for basically fire and very little police dispatch. Actually none, because it's state police and Moultonboro themselves. Town of Bristol is a little smaller than Moultonboro as far as population. Their service calls for 2011 were basically the same. Moultonboro paid almost $85,000 for that service. Bristol paid $27,000 for that service.
That's because of the assessed value.
It's the evaluation property.
Yeah.
We'd all love to live on a lake. We choose to live where we live.
So would I.
We all bought into this county for whatever reason, whether you like the lakes, mountains, whatever, the school mm-hmm. system. You chose to live where you live because you wanted to. The county is a county entity. Tax rate is set by the state for everybody in that county. As far as I know, it's off by a few cents on different towns, not by dollars. And I believe Moultonboro has the seventh lowest tax in the state. So I'm not sure if you're looking to save money, I think your money to save is in that dispatch for that fire department of $84,000, where it would only, if they came to the county, it would, if they choose to join the Ossipee Valley Association, again, pay the same as Sandwich, basically almost $5,000. Yes, the sheriff's department may need a very little upgrade, if any, to handle Moultonboro. Conway would be the biggest upgrade that we would need. We could take them on. How we would do that, that would obviously be a discussion, whether we man Conway's facilities or enlarge the dispatch center here. So I think you really need to take a look in town if you're looking to save money. Other than that, you need to talk to the representative to change your tax base, if that's what you're looking for.
I've chosen to live in many communities. Doesn't mean when I see something that isn't right, I don't try to change it. I'm sure there are many things that have occurred in the communities in which you live that you look at and you say, you know, that's just not right and something needs to be done about it. So I don't see that one.
Well, again,
the $84,000
I as a taxpayer would be probably upset if I was paying $85,000 for an outside county entity to dispatch for us. That's a choice that town made and went along with it.
And the taxpayers are actually quite comfortable with that decision. They made it convincingly some 10 years ago when it was brought up. Mm-hmm. They make it each and every year. This is a value-added service that we choose to buy. This is a value-added service that they chose to buy. They're buying it with our tax dollars. And we're suggesting that if they want that value-added service, they should pay for it completely with their tax dollars.
I almost hate to ask this question, but I will. So the towns are getting a value-added service by providing their own dispatch service. What value are they getting above and beyond what's available through the county?
Do you want to answer that?
Primarily, our lobby hours. Wolfeboro, Moultonboro, and Conway have substantial foot traffic into their departments. And that dispatch center serves as our first line reception, similar to if you walk in the main here, you take the left, you hit a window where the sheriff's staff is. That's our first frontline staff.
And 90% of the towns in the county also have that window service, whether it be a secretary or a part-time dispatcher, such as Moultonboro, or even Wakefield has a separate radio system that they can talk to their guys on in town, even though we dispatch for them full-time. So in other towns, it's the town clerk, such as the town of Albany. So there's a window service for most everybody, but anyone that has a PD has some type of window service. And that would not be going away at any time during this dispatch talks, because each town does like that service, and the townspeople do like having that hands-on-hand communication during the day hours most of the time. So again, it's not just those three towns that have those service. Most of the towns have some type of service.
Did that answer your question?
In Moultonboro, in the winter it's quieter because we're not as many tourists in the wintertime. But in the summer, I can tell you, there are cars at that PD going in at for people asking questions all the time. I mean, I'm sure it's the same in Wolfeboro and probably in Conway, because we explode in the summertime. 50,000, is that an even?
Yeah.
That's an easy number to say. So we utilize that facility especially in the summer and fall, more than anyone really realizes. I mean, there's traffic there all the time. There are people in and out of that. Ken.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Do you have any data on how many calls are generated that way?
Yes.
As opposed to phone calls?
Yes. I'd have to go back and pull those up.
I'd like to see that.
Yeah, we just did a study. Remember, we did a study.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Because everyone's call for service is different on what they categorize a call for service. A call for service, you know, when I hear call for service, I think you're calling someone out, or someone's on the road asking for help, or you made a stop or whatnot. Well, there are a lot of police departments that say call for service is just picking up the phone. That's a call for service.
Actually, my dispatch is called.
Yeah, so it's different. And I think sometimes numbers are deceiving on who's, if you're actually dispatching a car or making an actual stop to actually picking up the phone and answering a question. I know I was amazed about what the difference was, because I was always on the assumption call for service was being dispatched out.
Sir, in Wolfeboro, last year, I have information on here, there were 4,183 walk-ins during that year of 44,305 calls. That were...
So walk-ins mean into your department.
Right, yeah. So a little less than 10%.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else have any questions or comments?
One comment I've got to make is that we're missing DRA at this table or somebody to represent them so that we can have a better idea how this... is broken down by them. Really, it's their responsibility. They're the ones who are. But I mean, just for an information.
You mean the county tax itself?
Well, they're the ones who was.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Representative Wright I would disagree with you. The DRA's rate is set up for everybody. It's based on your assessment, your assessed value across the town. They're not going to come in and say, okay, we're going to lower the assessed rate. So it's a moot question how they do it or what. The fact is, we've got that rate. We've got that rate countywide, and the issue is who pays for the dispatch, not whether we can get DRA to lower our costs.
That's not really what I meant. I just want to know, why is it that we've got four counties that don't do it this way? DRA allows them to do that, obviously.
Because it's a fee-based. You can't lower the tax rate. They won't.
I understand that.
DRA. Yeah, we did talk to DRA. Go ahead.
The way those counties, and I know that in Grafton, when this was looked at, Holderness, Ashland, and some others were very firm in opposing any folding back. The county actually looked at giving up those and folding it back to everybody, putting that all in the tax rate. In simplest terms, let's say that the county has $22 million in total bills across the board. That's going to be it. That's everything they need to run this year. And the county and DRA look at all their sources of revenues, what they're going to take in for fees in the registries, and what they're going to take in for nursing home, and what they're going to get for sales at the county farm. And let's say you guys are going to have $10 million in revenue, non-tax revenue. And they subtract those, and they say, you have to raise by taxes $12 million. And they open up their handy little chart of how much each community has for their percentage of the equalized value. Mm-hmm. Not the assessed, but the DRA does a separate calculation, and they say that's your share. Let's say you following that same example, that you still have $22 million in revenues, or excuse me, expenses, but you have charged, and I'm just going to use a number here, $200,000 for this. So now you have income of $10,200,000. Leaving you $11,800,000 you have to raise by taxes. Mm-hmm. And now that has the chart applied, and then that gets distributed as well. The formulas, once you know the numbers, are actually very easy to plug in and calculate.
Then that number would be lower if there was a fee-based service. Right.
Yes, we still, we don't actually get the total benefit of the whole thing. But yes, if it's $400,000, now you're only raising $11,600,000 in taxes. So any fee for service, if you look at the county revenues and added a line of fee for service, revenues go up, taxes go down.
Almost like the fee for service for Albany, for you to patrol. I mean, I'm just giving you, for you to patrol Albany, they pay you $10,000. That's a revenue.
We did not ask for that fee. We did not give them a fee. They asked their town, just by vote, how much do you want to raise for mm-hmm. the county to provide directed patrol in
right.
the town of Albany? And it's even at a higher rate. It's at a overtime rate.
Commercial rate.
A detail rate. So that's what they chose to do. So they have a basically self-made police department mm-hmm. for very limited hours during the year. Mm-hmm. And that was, it's actually $20,000 that they, for the last 2 years, have chosen to vote and approve.
And that's we put that as a revenue, if I recall.
Right, sure. It goes in and out.
Yep.
But I just add, and not disagreeing with your explanation, because I think it was accurate, but when you say it's fee-based service, and let's say Ossipee's fee for the dispatch is $50,000, and Moultonboro's is $5,000 if you go to this fee-based service. So that means Ossipee resident taxes will go up and Moultonboro would go down a little. Am I right on that?
Well, that $200,000 or $400,000, yes, gets distributed, whatever. So if...
So just the blanket thing where you said that the revenue goes up and the taxes go down, that's only...
On the county side, yes.
That's only for certain things.
That's for the county side.
I think it depends on how it is set up and structured.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And if every community pays some base, or I see in Grafton County, just reading this description, that 25% of the cost is subsidized by the county. So there's, you know, every town pays 25% of the, the county pays 25% of the cost. And then the towns are assessed on the basis of the activity, the number of calls for the balance, the remaining 75%. So that's a model that's out there, and there's nothing saying we would have to use that model or any of the other, you know, we can structure our own model here and try to make it as equitable as possible.
Commissioner.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I guess in my campaign for commissioner, I was the one that instigated this whole thing, and it's my feeling that, A, it's unfair for people to pay for things they don't use, and B, that at some level, every town in this county has a responsibility to pay for something that sometimes they're going to use. So I'm not advocating you get rid of the whole system,
no.
But I think a fair way to do it is a base rate and then pay for service. And I wanted to ask Dave, in your information there, is that how do you, if it's based on calls, is this a history of calls? Because certainly you can't set up a budget not knowing how many calls they're going to use at the end of the year.
Yeah.
Or is it the previous year? Do you have any idea?
You probably have to do it on the previous year, but like I said,
is it a history?
You could phase this in over, you know, 3 years, whatever, so that the impact is sort of gradual on the communities and we can get used to the new system. I mean, we're not necessarily asking for, we're not demanding immediate relief. We would like to see some change, but how you structure it will make the difference.
The ambulance, if I might go back to that example, follows, each community pays a baseline, irrespective of how many calls they have. And that's a agreement that the four towns came to that they felt was a reasonable share based upon population, some history of calls, and some value of property. So we have this baseline that we share, and then we have what I call on the knock-on cost, the extra. And we follow an October 1 to a September 30 history.
Right.
And along about mid-October, the ambulance company sends out a letter of, okay, the total contract is, and again, I'm just using some numbers here, $450,000. And the baseline is $150,000. So there's $30,000 that's left to be distributed on this percentage. And they say, okay, Moultonboro, this year you had 40% of the calls, and Meredith, you had 45% of the calls, and Sandwich, you had 5% of the calls, and Center Harbor, you had 10% of the calls. So they take that $300,000 and they multiply it by the 40, 45, 5, 10, and they say, so here's your base costs, and here's your add-on costs, and this is how much you're going to owe for the coming year. So we get that in October. It doesn't actually take effect until July 1 of the coming year. And the reason for that is, at one time, one of the towns was talking about going to a fiscal year. So this way, whether you're on a calendar year or a fiscal year, you, in October, know what that's going to be come January 1, come July 1. And there's
various different ways to work it out. And as Dave has suggested, we're not looking to shock people all at once. You know, a 3 to 5 year transition, obviously we'd like shorter. Obviously longer's a lot softer on people's, other people's budgets. We certainly understand this would be a big change, and to transition it over a period of time, as David suggested, we think is an extremely reasonable approach to take. If you agree with our approach at all.
No more comments?
I guess the lieutenant brought up a good point that in when this all started, committee was formed, and it was basically the sheriff's office with the delegate representatives in the three towns representing that they want this change. Did Conway even come to the first one, first of all? Because I haven't seen him since.
They did come to the first one.
Yes. So Conway's interest in seeing this go through, I think, is at best very limited to see this go that way. I've had communication with them. They're really not on board with this for whatever reasons. And also, there's no entities represented here that of the other towns that would get hit by this. The Albany's, the Bartlett's. Ossipee does have a representative here who happens to be for it. But the other towns, the Wakefields, I think they should have some say on where this may go or not go, because I think it would be very valuable as far as their input and why they may like it or may not like it. And I think the representation that you're using for these four sheriff's offices that have some system in place, every one of them have different services that they provide, to include the reporting that is all shared by the counties, the towns and the counties, so that they all have the same database. We are looking towards that because that is the way to go at this point. Maine and Massachusetts are doing it, and New Hampshire has jumped on board very strongly.
For uniform reporting, you're saying?
It's more than that. It's sharing the database as far as who's getting stopped, who's out there for criminals, or anything. But it all ties into one. So if someone pulls it up in Wolfeboro, then someone in Bartlett sees it. Mm-hmm. So they may have something that ties in with that person or not.
And Conway dispatch will able to see on their screens what our dispatch is doing or what Wolfeboro dispatch is doing.
Right. And then it all, even goes down to if we go to that level, if everything falls right, that the officers in the vehicles, if they have the system, would see immediate responses as far as a car stop and all that. So, but that's a ways off. Grafton County, I know, also in that service has towns in Vermont that they're servicing for. So that's included in that, and in Coos County. And some of their, I think Hanover is not included in that. So each, like I say, agency has different services that they are providing for those fees. We're just, at this point, a dispatch center.
And this is just an exploratory committee. Obviously, I think the representatives mm-hmm. will make the decision, and those mm-hmm. representatives will represent those towns. I was just noticing that, you know, you have three, well, it's supposed to be four, but three delegates who are, you know, neutral, supposed to be a commission, right. represented from the commissioners.
Completely neutral.
And you have two towns who want, and you have two towns that want the change, but you don't have any towns that might be opposed to it. That was the only thing I was throwing out there. We keep hearing, and I'm not.
They have yet to be invited, basically. So I think we may be at that stage where, if there is a next meeting, that I think it should be put out to representatives of those towns.
Or the selectmen, or...
Right. I think we definitely need another meeting, because we have some information that we didn't have, so I'm sure I want to go over it, Karel. And our delegation meeting was moved to October. I believe it's not going to be in September. So I'm hoping maybe we could meet again sometime this month and come back. And if you feel, I don't know if you can have any more information. I don't know how you guys feel about that. I mean, to report to the delegation what I have right now isn't a lot, basically.
First, Conway, certainly they signed the letter. Earl's an interesting fellow, as is, you know, this issue, and I think he's felt very comfortable with our representation of it, but I will secure a letter from Conway as to their current status of their interest in this. I do think we're missing a very important piece, which is of the $900,000, if the county were dispatching only for itself, what would that budget be? And what is the spread? Because that's the piece that we're talking about distributing. We're not talking about distributing in a different fashion the first 400,000 or 500 or 600, because we don't know what the number is. So we don't know what the spread is. And without knowing what the spread is, you can't talk about what's getting allocated to anybody else. So it is, to me, it's very difficult to have a conversation of the impact upon Tuftonboro or Ossipee or the Ossipee Fire Mutual Aid District or anybody else. We don't know the numbers. We still don't have
them. Well, what was the purpose of
my own personal opinion on that, as far as of that $900,000, very little, if any, would change as far as the dispatch, because county dispatch is needed as far as to get the deputies from corner to corner in the county. So we still need every tower, every radio piece that we have in place right now. And we're 24 hours.
Yeah. I don't think the charge of the committee is to diminish the dispatch center. We know that the dispatch center, I would think, would stay the same unless the three towns joined you.
That's not what
I just portrayed.
Because
no, I think you misunderstood. No, because
the question becomes, let's say that you weren't dispatching for any of these. What would the county have to dispatch for itself?
Why do you want that? Why do you need that?
Well, because that tells us the base figure. If you really wanted to compare it to the ambulance contract, and that's what I know because I was there, is that's a base figure to operate just for you. But we're not looking as a subcommittee. This isn't what the delegation, the charge was. It was basically to see, and we're the ones at this table that are trying to dissect it, with any other better word, is what does it cost for you to run your dispatch if it was just the sheriff's department and not any of these towns? Would for you to dispatch your people to do your jobs that you do on a daily basis, and what would it cost to do that without taking in Bartlett and Effingham and taking their calls for service? What would it cost for you just to run your department, dispatch department?
Again, it'd be very little change, if at all, because we need what we have, because we do everything.
I don't disagree with you.
Civil to criminal. So to say that we need two or three dispatches less.
No. Well, you're misunderstanding. It's not where this committee's going, and that's not what the charge of this committee was.
You're trying to get a base rate,
but not to diminish it, just to get an idea of how much more it takes to run your department because you have these additional tons. We're not going to say, I can't imagine the delegation going, let's just dispatch for the sheriffs and forget the rest of the time. That's not really what it's about.
The systems that are in place, we still need.
And you'll still have.
We'll still have, right.
You'll still have.
I think I can help.
Thank you.
I think what's happening is that we're saying that because we need basically the same equipment and resources, no matter whether we serve one town or 10 towns or however many towns, the base fee is going to be pretty much what the towns are already paying now. So there may not be a savings by going for a base fee plus whatever you call the other fee.
Well,
yeah.
I mean, I don't think our expectations were that Moultonboro would save hundreds of thousands of dollars by doing this. I don't believe that Wolfeboro feels the same way, or Conway. I think what we're saying is we're paying a portion to the county to dispatch for other towns when we aren't utilizing the service basically at all. So I think, I don't think there would be a drastic change in the cost. I think it would give a little relief, maybe, for Moultonboro, Wolfeboro, and Conway, but I don't expect it to be huge.
If I may, I've worked with a half a dozen dispatch centers in my career. And there is a difference between whether someone is dispatching 25,000 calls a year or 65,000 calls a year. There's a point at which one dispatcher has to go to two. There's a point at which one station has to go to two. So I would say there may be some dispatchers involved, because a dispatch center for 25, 30,000 calls a year needs a certain amount of equipment. That's going to pretty much stay the same. Usually you have to add a station. There's some other things you have to do. A dispatcher can handle so many calls. We're above that point. I don't know exactly what the break point is for this center. They can be different in different centers depending upon the kinds of calls you're getting and the like. And I do think that we need to know what those add-on costs are, because that, to me, is the part that's in dispute. If it takes $600,000 for the sheriff's office to maintain its countywide towers and its systems here, but it's spending $900,000 because it has gone above the point at which one dispatcher or one station or one whatever, that's the point that I think we need to get a handle on in order to say, okay, so then that gets, how does that get allocated? What does it look like?
So we're trying to come up with figures to maybe a different model, as you say, come up with a baseline, and that's your idea of a baseline, and you, there might be a different one with other models on a baseline, but that's kind of what you're trying to come up with, is how, what's going to be the baseline, and then you can work off that.
Mm-hmm.
If that's really where we should be headed for the next meeting, and okay. Come up with ideas on that, and that's what obviously Moultonboro's idea is. I don't know what yours is, and we'd have to look at the other. Is that fair to say, I guess?
Commissioner.
Sheriff and Lieutenant and Keith, do you people have a national organization or a New England organization that you attend a conference or that you can go to and perhaps come up with two or three? We might give you two or three ways to finance this as a call per service or some other way to give us some ideas.
We
know what happens in the state, but what about other?
Well, I think if you start going out of state or national, then you're getting into a whole different ball of wax, mm-hmm. as far as how are they counting their numbers, how, mm-hmm. what are they servicing.
Get some more information.
I think you're better off staying in state for one. And there are several different in the four that you presented. They all do it different. Okay. And like I said, Rockingham's is just initially to see that their capital reserve, a town of Derry, does not want to put in as much as a town that's going to use that 100%. And I guess if nothing else, maybe that's what this committee may be looking at in the near future here, as far as, because we are looking to do quite a bit of upgrades, talking with Moultonboro and them attending the meetings, the chief and the lieutenant from over there, and the other agencies, as far as what the county may bring on board as far as resources or services. So maybe that's more practical as far as looking at a capital reserve fund for upgrades. The consoles are getting old, as every other sheriff's department in the state is. The state's also trying to update their systems. So statewide, your dispatch centers are needing help and needing updated in equipment. And they're all going to be substantial. I'm not going to not tell you that. Mm-hmm. So I guess I'll put that out there.
Well,
so to get your figure, we're going to need that time consuming. Is that what you would like? Is that what you're asking us?
Well, there's WAG, there's SWAG, and there's spot on.
Yeah.
Wild arse guess, scientific wild arse guess, and perhaps an extremely time consuming, labor intensive. I personally would be satisfied with SWAG has taken the first cut at this. And with due respect, you must have some gut check.
I think so.
For what percentage of these things are truly county type functions. And I personally would think that would be a reasonable way to start. But you also have a sense of, at what point do you have to top up with additional resources? I know how many calls, whether it was Spencer or Flint or Pittsfield, Mass, or even Moultonboro, I know how many calls we can handle with how many staff. I'm sure you have a similar experience based upon the depth of your knowledge of these.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Perhaps for this next meeting that you want to set, the parties can work on some different models.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we can look at the other counties in New Hampshire again and see what they're doing. And these gentlemen can perhaps, you know, do likewise, or, you know, look at what other agencies are doing and bring back some models that we could talk about at this next meeting.
With the next meeting, would it give you enough time if we met at the end of September, before the delegation meeting? Would that give you enough time? Or I'm not sure when the chairman's going to call. I don't know if she gave us a date for October, but sometime in October. Is a month more, or is it?
No, I mean, around the third week or September or fourth week, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We'll do our best to get some.
I'm actually gone the last week.
Okay.
September.
That's the ICMA conference is the week before that. That's
so the last 2 weeks of September for Earl, Dave, myself are
okay,
pretty
so
much out, I think.
I don't know. Commissioner, do you have any idea when she might call the delegation?
As far as I know, Madam Chairman, we haven't been told yet.
No,
last
I
knew
it
was September, maybe early October.
I did get an email that they were going
to
postpone it until October.
Well, usually, isn't it the third Monday usually?
In the month?
When they have them?
When they
it
have
seems
them.
To be.
I'd have to go back and look in my calendar. I don't know. I mean,
we shoot for the second week of October, because first week is Friday.
Columbus Day, yeah. If it would, should we shoot for a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday?
Well, I think that if Dave and I and Mike Owen, the fellow who runs the day to day, could perhaps get an hour and a half just to toss around some different models and some
fun
budget information, we could then probably do some things by email and have something the first week in October.
But I do think that one more face-to-face, at least between the number crunchers here, would help move that along, at least in terms of models. I'm not saying agreeing or disagreeing. I'm just saying at least in terms of a couple of models for presentation.
Well, obviously, that's what you have to do.
When do the commissioners meet? On Wednesday?
On Wednesdays at 8:30.
Every week?
Every Wednesday.
Okay. Well, Mondays are pretty good for me. I know, Susan, sometimes they're not for you.
By that point, things might be, Mondays might be a little more flexible.
How about you, Ted?
I'm fine.
You're fine. Mm-hmm. You're working, so you guys can show up. So are we looking at the 14th? When is Columbus Day? Columbus Day is the weekend.
I think that is
That is Columbus Day?
Yeah.
Oh, sandwich.
The 30th.
Sandwich Fair, right?
Yeah.
What's the 7th? Is 7th the Freiburg Fair of October?
I don't know.
Sandwich Fair is...
It's the first, Freiburg's the first 10 days of October, and then... Sandwich Fair is the official, non-official Columbus Day.
Columbus, right. It is, so that's the 14th. So
Is this the sweating year for Freiburg, where every 5 years or something like that?
It probably starts September 29th.
Yeah, starts.
Yeah. I think that's what I actually saw.
Typical day starts and
runs that Saturday.
I'm thinking the 7th is Columbus Day.
No, the 14th is. I'm looking
14th
at my calendar.
Is, yeah. Yeah.
The 14th is Columbus Day. Can we do the 7th? Would that work? Are you back?
What day is it?
Monday.
That's not Sandwich Fair Day?
No, Sandwich Fair is the 14th.
That's Columbus Day weekend.
Sandwich Fair is usually the last weekend of Freiburg.
Sandwich Fair is
Sandwich
always
Fair is on Columbus Day.
Columbus Day, always.
This is a swing year
just
for
the
Freiburg.
Way that
they
worked
start
out.
Earlier, just the way the calendar falls.
Next week?
We're paying for that magic phone. Why don't we just
no,
Google Sandwich Fair and see what the dates are?
You're not paying for that phone, sir.
Ted can Google Sandwich Fair. I'm sure it's Columbus Day weekend.
Ed's doing it right now. I can tell.
This is.
I think the 7th. I know the 7th is not Sandwich Fair weekend.
So put the 7th, and if it change it.
I can change it.
No, September.
Is 9 o'clock a good time for everyone? 9.
So will this be a meeting that we would invite representatives from the other towns to attend?
If you feel they should.
As an opponent, I absolutely would. As a proponent, I think we need one more discussion. I don't think we have any models to present
to everybody
just yet. This delegation may decide it likes a model. It may decide it doesn't want to recommend any.
Yeah. Well, I think
but
at the
why
end
not?
Yeah.
Why not give there's them an opportunity problem. To give some input to create a good problem. Model?
Okay. Are we thinking of inviting police department? Or are we thinking
no.
of inviting
I think
town
like select managers, or
selectmen, or
yeah.
Okay.
So maybe you could send a notice to each town and have them.
Give them
that was the most appropriate.
Would feel to be appropriate. Sure.
What did say next Wednesday?
So October 7th, 9 o'clock. I'll check and make sure this room is available.
You think it has a
you wanted the dates of the sandwich fair?
Yeah.
October 12th, 13th, and 14th.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's Columbus.
That's always
Columbus
Mike, if Dave and I came over at the 5th or the 6th of September. Are you available on one of those for an hour and a half?
What day is that?
Do we need to be amongst ourselves?
Thursday. Yeah, we can chat.
Will you guys work that out with
me? I could probably figure that out. I probably would.
Okay.
Next meeting on the
shoot me an email, but yeah, I think so.
Right.
And if there's no other questions or comments or concerns, I'll close this meeting at 10:28. Thank you very much for coming.
Mike, what's your email? I seem to have trouble getting emails over here for some reason. Sheriff in particular.
Well, his is different because I've tried several, but I did get in.